Mulan, the woman who cross-dressed her way into our hearts. She has become a symbol of modern feminism as a kick-ass warrior who imbues ferocity, almost like a raging fire, or maybe more like a coursing river. The lyricist for the movie Mulan has a flair for the comedic arts, which is shown off in his many different productions. But who put words to Mulan's amazing music? Let's find out. Before we start, don't forget to check out our Patreon, our Discord, and of course, like and subscribe. David Zippel was born in 1954 and raised in Easton, Pennsylvania. His interest in musical theater blossomed thanks to his parents at a young age. Maybe not that early.
I was, 7 or 8 years old. My parents took me to see a production in a tent in the Round in Lambertville, New Jersey, of The Music Man. It was because it was in the Round, it was scenically very limited. But each scenic effect was magic, and I just couldn't believe that suddenly street lights flew in, and we were now on the street, and mm-hmm. then it moved to another location, and I just was blown away by that, and I got goosebumps.
Yeah, it was like magic to you.
Exactly. At the end of elementary school, I used to take popular songs from the radio, and I would write parody lyrics, mostly about my teachers, to make my friends laugh.
Sure.
And I kind of liked doing that. So I kept writing, and I started writing songs for real by the time I got to junior high. As I realized that while I had the courage to get on stage, I also had what I thought was pretty good taste, and I would never hire me to act in anything.
I was a musical theater nerd, but I was a jazz nerd. I loved Billy Joel and Joni Mitchell. So I had a very eclectic group of songwriters I admired.
David first attended the University of Pennsylvania. Before graduating with a BA in 1976, he was offered an opportunity in Washington, D.C.
While I was in college, I directed a bit, and I started working on a project with a couple of composers and other writers I met. Nothing that really came to fruition until I guess I was a junior, and a friend of mine who was a guest director at the University of Pennsylvania, where I was an undergrad. He was the head of the theater department at Temple University. And he was directing a show in Washington, D.C., an equity professional show, and the lyricist quit. Mm-hmm. And Joe called me and said, I think I might have a job for you. So I auditioned. I wrote a song. I didn't have a composer at the time. And I wrote the music and the lyrics. And it was a song about the Washington Press Corps called Don't Mess with the Press. And they loved it. And they said, write us another one. And I wrote a second song. This time, there was a kid down the hall who played the piano really well. And I asked him if he'd write it with me. And he did. So we wrote a second song and ultimately got hired to finish the show. We wrote 5 new songs. The show was called Rotunda. Uh-huh. And it was a sort of a political soap opera. It was creamed by the critics. One doesn't forget these things.
Sure.
The Washington Post, which was the main critic, didn't like the show, but singled out 3 songs that were mine. So I thought, well, that was nice.
That is nice.
But the Washington Star said, and I quote, "In Rotunda, there's not a character you could like, a melody you can hum, or a lyric that doesn't automatically upgrade your opinion of the Burma-shaved bards."
Even though David's interests were in musical theater, he decided that he wanted a contingency plan. He decided law was a good backup and was accepted into some school called Harvard. A real Mark Zuckerberg type, even at Harvard, David continued to pursue his real ambition, writing several pop songs with singer Pamela Stanley that appeared on her 1979 album, This Is Hot, and collaborating on 3 songs with Wally Harper, Barbara Cook's musical director, whose performance of the songs at Carnegie Hall in 1980 marked Zippel's own New York theatrical debut. In 1976, David passed the bar exam and went to pursue his career in musical theater.
So Barbara Cook, who I revered and do to this day, was singing at the Copley Plaza Hotel in downtown Boston, and I was at Harvard Law School, and so I hopped the train and went into town to see her, and it was in this odd little cabaret. I'm sure it doesn't exist anymore. It was called the Merry-Go-Round or the carousel, whatever it was. It was, she was on a Lazy Susan that slowly revolved.
No.
Was still. And so every maybe 3 or 4 minutes, she would kind of move by you. You could just sort of wave at her. And her set was brilliant. And I was in heaven. And it was right around my birthday. So my parents had sent me a little money for my birthday so I could afford to go a second time. So the following week, I went back. And as I was leaving, I was walking through the lobby, and there was Barbara Cook and Wally Harper just standing there. Had to walk past them to leave, so of course I gushed a little bit, and they were very kind. And at this moment, as fate would have it, Eva Marie Saint, the actress, was doing a play in Boston and walked up to Barbara, and there I was talking to Wally Harper. So I told him how much I liked his music, and that I thought his partner's lyrics were excellent. And he said, oh, well, we don't write together anymore. And I thought, if that isn't the bell of opportunity ringing loudly. So I said, well, I'm a law student, but what I really want to do is write lyrics for the theater. And he said, oh, my God, a good lyricist is really hard to find. And I said, well, I'd be happy to show you my work at some time. He said, you know what? Barbara and I are going to have breakfast tomorrow. Why don't you come not too early and meet us? And then you can show me some of what you've written.
While working with Wally, David continued to gain valuable experience.
I had one song that was supposed to save. There was a musical on Broadway called Marilyn, an American Fable. We used to call it Marilyn, an American Foible. This is long before Smash. Mm-hmm. And it was a musical about Marilyn Monroe with a happy ending. So mm-hmm. Imagine that.
Yeah.
And she ran off into the Hollywood sign with Arthur Miller in this particular version. It was in previews and a mess. And my collaborator, also the man I wrote for Barbara Cook with, a man named Wally Harper, was called in to work on the musical direction and to fix the show. And so we wrote one song for that. And that song actually stopped the show in a good way and was also encouraging, you know, I just thought, I can do this. So it's a long process, but I was very lucky to get a little bit of positive feedback early on mm-hmm. to just give me the confidence to keep going.
David's big break came 5 years later, thanks to a connection he made in law school.
While I was at law school, one of my friends was the son of a rather prominent theater attorney. And my friend showed my work to his father, and he said he'd represent me. So when I got out of law school, I had a good lawyer. And he also represented Cy Coleman and Larry Gelbart. Mm-hmm. It took about 5 years for Cy to notice me. My attorney, a wonderful man named Albert Da Silva, and his wife were huge fans and great friends, and they advocated for me. And I think Cy liked things to be his idea. So he didn't seem particularly interested. And then about 5 years later, I did an off-Broadway review called It's Better with a Band, which was a review of my stuff. I mean, it's sort of a weird way to begin your career with a career retrospective, but that's what I did. And Cy saw the review, and then he came to see it, and he called me in for a meeting. And we met and talked about another project that he was asking me if I were interested in. And I said, well, what about that film noir with a jazz score that I'd read about in the New York Times about a year and a half earlier with Larry Gelbart, who is one of my heroes and one of the great writers of film and theater. He created MASH for TV and Tootsie the movie, and he was an amazing writer. And Cy said, well, why don't we write? He said, let me get back to you on that. We're talking to some big shots at the moment for that. I think those were his words. So I said, oh, okay, but if you would consider me, I'd love to take a shot at it. And they called me back about 6 months later and said, why don't we start and we'll write 3 songs, and at the end of which we'll decide whether we're going to go forward together, which was a very kind way of saying whether or not I was fired. So I wrote the first song, and it was a music first song. So I played me this beautiful melody, and I don't know if you know the show, but it became a song called Lost and Found, and they were both really enthusiastic. Private eyes.
case of with Every Breath I Take, he played me this melody, and I just thought, oh, this is astonishingly beautiful. If I can write this lyric that will be acceptable to him and to Larry Gelbart, not only will I have gotten a job, but I will have written a Cy Coleman standard. Yeah. So I thought this was, you know, a dream opportunity, but it was a little daunting as well. And Cy had played me the melody, and on the spot, I came up with the title, and he said, I love that title. That's great. So I took the song and the title home with me, and he was going on a little vacation. I think it was winter. He went someplace in the Caribbean. So I knew he was going to be gone for about 10 or 14 days. So I worked on it, and I wrote my first lyric to that music, and I thought, I like this. Mm-hmm. But then I thought, oh, well, what if he doesn't? So I wrote 12 different additional variations of the same
for
lyric.
Him that That's you great. Thought he would like.
And I showed up at his office, and with the one I liked best, which is still the one I wrote first, on top. And he just sat at the piano and played it down and sang the song to the lyric. And he said, this is terrific. Let's call Larry. So while he went to call Larry, I slipped the other 12 versions away, threw them away. And we never looked back.
Oh, that's great.
You were the one who said forever from the start. And I've been drifting since you've gone. Out on a lonely sea that only you can chart.
City of Angels earned 11 Tony Award nominations, winning 6, including Best Musical. It also won the Drama Desk Award for Outstanding Lyrics, Olivier Awards for Best New Musical of 1994, and Best Musical Revival in 2015. David's next big production was in 1993, with a stage adaptation for Neil Simon's 1977 screenplay, The Goodbye Girl. Fun fact about Neil Simon, he has received more combined Oscar and Tony Award nominations than any other writer. So just thank us when you win that bar trivia next time, huh?
Once I was working with Marvin Hamlisch, and we did a musical version of The Goodbye Girl, the Neil Simon film.
Yeah.
And in fact, you can find the American cast album. There's a song called What a Guy. And it's at the 11 o'clock number, the big turn of the story moment in the show. And we'd written two or three other songs for it. They were all either too serious or it wasn't working. And I went to see Marvin, and I threw a title at him. Oh, no, he wrote a melody.
Okay.
And I thought it was fun. And I think, again, he thought it was a ballad. But I had this idea of calling the song What a Guy. And it's the song where the character, Bernadette Peters played her on Broadway, sings about Elliot Garfield, a struggling actor that she loathed at the beginning, that she suddenly realizes is wonderful. And
sure.
So it turned into sort of a comic song, but with a lot of emotion. I wrote it overnight, and I came to Marvin the next day and played it for him. Because it was so fast, and he was so excited, I went home. And the first thing the following morning, I got this package in the mail. It was a baseball jacket. It was a yellow and blue suede jacket. It just arrived in my size with a note. It was so exciting that he was so excited about the song that he sent me a gift.
What a guy is a guy with one hell of a nerve. But he's kind and he's good and he thinks this is what I deserve. And it's hard to disagree when a guy like this loves me.
The Goodbye Girl was nominated for 5 Tony Awards, including Best Musical and a Drama Desk Award nomination for Outstanding Lyrics. Around 1994, David Zippel was approached by Richard Rich to compose songs for the Swan Princess, with help from Lex de Azevedo. The duo composed such songs as Far Longer Than Forever,
Sure as the dawn brings the sunrise, weave an unshakable bond,
destined to last for a lifetime and beyond. Far longer than forever.
Far longer than forever.
I swear that I'll be true.
I swear that I'll be true.
I've made an everlasting vow to find a way to you.
And this is my idea.
We've tried all summer, but we just can't lose her.
Hey, fellas, wait up!
Quick, put on some speed.
When picking teams, I'd never choose her.
You'd think she'd take a hint and learn to read.
This really isn't fair.
We really couldn't care.
Boys, it's all or none. This is not my
this
idea.
This isn't my idea.
I think that opening number of The Swan Princess was a song that I had the idea to tell the story in that fashion and wrote into it fairly extensively. And then Lex took a stab at it. And once he found the shape of the verses, then I could replicate them and continue. So that was very much a back and forth process with me leading the way. But
right.
I think like the Far Longer Than Forever, I think I may have given him the title,
Yep. But
most of the music came first.
A few years later, Zippel got the Disney call thanks to a past collaboration with the patron saint of Disney musicals, Alan Menken. Alan suggested Zippel's help on the upcoming movie, Hercules. Zippel's flair for comedy was a perfect fit for the movie. Together, the duo wrote amazing melodies with clever lyrics for the songs like Gospel Truth. Zero to Hero, and the unforgettable ballad, Go the Distance, which received an Academy Award nomination for Best Original Song.
It's funny, now that's a song that was music first. It came very late in the creation of the film Hercules. We had a ballad early in the film called Shooting Star, which was just beautiful. But another song that was supposed to be the takeaway pop song for Megara, the character, the female character. And that was called I Can't Believe My Heart. And it was about her cynicism and how knowing Hercules changed it. So we thought that was going to be the pop song.
Yeah.
But then as we worked on the film, we discovered it was late in the game to have a ballad. And so we rewrote that with a song called I Won't Say I'm in Love, which involved the Greek chorus, the soul-singing muses, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was a little more fun and had a little a wink to it. We found ourselves without a pop song. So we went back and we took out the song we loved, Shooting Star, and we had to write a new song that would be a ballad that could be a pop song that could talk about Hercules's journey and at the same time function in the movie and ultimately be the underscoring for the picture.
Yeah.
So Alan went off and wrote the music first. And so you would think that the title came first in that particular instance, just because, you know, when I thought of Go the Distance, hearing the music, I couldn't believe that no one had ever written that title before. It just seemed so, how could that not have been? So
right.
it was very exciting. We really struck gold on that one.
Till I find my hero's welcome right where I belong.
But our favorite song from the film and our go-to karaoke song is one that showcases Zippel's ability to tell a story through clever lyrics. The anti-love song, I Won't Say I'm in Love. Immediately after Hercules wrapped, Zippel was paired with Matthew Wilder for Disney's next film, Mulan.
I met with Matthew to discuss the story of Mulan and the possibility of working together. And right from the start, it was a good match. We've been having a good time.
David's so brilliant. He's very musical. We both have a real understanding of each other, so it makes for a really good collaboration.
Our and everyone else's favorite song is the power ballad, Make a Man Out of You.
Get down to business to defeat the Huns. Did they send me daughters? Then I am
Entertainment Weekly writes, like the character of Mulan, the song is an unlikely hero. I never thought a song as quirky as that was going to attract as much attention as it did, said Wilder. Yet it seemed almost charmed from the start, with Wilder and Zippel landing on what would become the final version of the song the first time they presented it to Disney. We came in with the first draft of the song and everybody said, oh my god, this is good. We're excited. We were very lucky with that one, remembers Zippel. The song started with the lyrics, and Zippel said he knew he'd hit on something great when he devised the title, ironically contrasting Mulan's gender with the concept of what it means to be a man. Zippel notes, it was trying to be ironic and humorous and in character at all times. Arguably, the most impactful song from the film, however, is Reflection.
Look at me, I will never pass for a perfect bride. Or a perfect daughter, can it be? I'm not meant to play this part. Now I see that if I were truly to be myself, I would break my family's heart.
The song was sung by Lea Salonga, who you can find out more about right here. It's a beautiful, soul-searching song, which shows Zippel's more serious side. Reflection also struck a chord with the LGBT community. Entertainment Weekly writes, while hosting a dinner party at his apartment in New York City, a visiting family brought their 15-year-old son, who asked if he had written Mulan. He started to get all choked up, and I said, what is it? And he said, I was going to commit suicide because I was gay, and I didn't know how to tell my parents. I didn't know how to tell anyone. I heard the song Reflection, and the lyrics, when will my reflection show who I am inside, gave me the courage to tell my parents, who embraced me and accepted me, and it changed my life, recounts Zippel. That moment alone made being a songwriter worth my whole life. That our song had that effect on him was wonderful and very powerful. The music and lyrics for Mulan received an Academy Award nomination for Best Musical or Comedy Score and won an Annie Award nomination for Music in an Animated Feature Production. Also, the cover of Reflection, as sung by Christina Aguilera, helped launch her career. She also performed it at the 50th celebration for Walt Disney World during their new fireworks show. Continuing his foray into film, but outside Disney, David teamed up with Christina and Todd Chapman to write the song We're a Miracle, which was featured as the end title song for Pokemon the First Movie and on its number one soundtrack album. A few years later, David finally got the opportunity to work with composer Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Don't cry for me, Argentina.
There was a general manager who managed Andrew's shows in New York, who was a friend. Even before we were friends, he had seen a reading of my work and was very enthusiastic about it. And I think it was in the early 80s, he had told Andrew that he should meet with me. We met probably 9 years after that, but he was already engaged with another lyricist on another project. And over the years, he would call me and we would say, we must work on something together, but it never happened. And then in, I think, 2002, he called me about The Woman in White, which is a 700-page Wilkie Collins Victorian novel. And I'm thinking, oh my God, this scares the hell out of me to write a through composed musical with that much plot. But I figured since it scared me, I definitely had to do it. And we enjoyed writing it. It was a good experience.
I admit that I am a criminal, obsessed with perfect crimes. An evil one has good designs, can bungle it sometimes. Yes, evil one who is a genius, can now and then get in a scrape upon. No one ever's a catastrophe, as long as you escape.
The music and lyrics received a Tony Award nomination for Best Original Score. The show was nominated for 5 Laurence Olivier Awards, including Best Musical. In 2011, David teamed up again with Alan Menken and wrote the acclaimed USO sequence, Star Spangled Man with a Plan, for Captain America. Around the same time, he partnered with Liza Minnelli and wrote the script for Liza's at the Palace, which won a 2010 Tony Award for Best Special Entertainment. And yes, our dates are right. Feel old yet? Most recently, David has partnered again with Andrew Lloyd Webber to write the lyrics for Cinderella, which is currently showing at the Gillian Lynn Theatre in London as of October 31st, 2021.
It's got such a great sense of humor. Charlotte Jones is the book writer, and I think we all have a very, we want her to be fun and funny, and we want the show, we've really rethought the story, so it's totally reimagined. I think that Prince being gay is sort of a red herring. It's not quite as you will expect it to be, but I think audiences are really going to enjoy it. We're having such a good time with it. I can't imagine other people won't as well. And it's going to be so beautiful. The designs are astonishing.
Mr. David Zippel is a fascinating individual who has been blessed with an amazing gift. After completing college, he was able to go out and live his dream. His various compositions have touched the lives of many and will continue to do so throughout the future. I mean, we hope so. We gotta crank these episodes out somehow. Thank you to these people for your generous support, and a special thank you to John David. You guys are really helping keep this channel afloat. Thank you. Thank you for watching this episode of Discographies. Don't forget to check out our Patreon and Discord, and click the thumbs up button below if you liked the video. And if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, subscribe and click the bell. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked below. We hope to see you in another Discography.